Welcome to our talk, Trust is Good, Control is Better, a short story about network policies. So first, a short introduction. This is Maximilian. He is a cloud platform engineer at InnoVex. I'm Johannes. I'm also a cloud platform engineer at InnoVex. And if you want to find me on Twitter, GitHub, or somewhere else, this is my handle, Yoshoya. And if you want to know what InnoVex is doing, just come after the talk to us and ask us. So what can you expect from this talk? You should get an overview about challenges if you implement or use network policies in the context of Kubernetes. And also, you should get an overview which different aspects of network policies or testing and validating of your Kubernetes setup can make sense and which tools fit best. So at first, some questions for you. Who uses Kubernetes? Just raise your arm. OK, mostly everyone. Who uses network policies in the setup? OK, not so many. And who had any issues with network policies? Just so few, OK. I'm fascinated. So why should you test your network policies? And we have here four aspects, how and why you can test them. So the first one is, from my perspective, Kubernetes is pretty complex. You have a ton of adjustment screws and flags. And it's pretty hard to predict if all the combinations of flags are making sense, for example. And if you, for example, activate IP masquerading, does the network policy still taking place, for example? Does the combination of your CNI plugin, the version, and your kubeproxy works together? And also, it's hard to predict if your activate network policies are still your ingress controller working and your load balances, for example. Or maybe you have some network policies that prevent your load balances from still working. And the next one is Kubernetes itself doesn't really implement the policies. So it's just an RP object, for example. So you can create them, and the Kubernetes RP server will store them in the etcd. And everything is loosely coupled. And the CNI plugin, for example, Calico, will listen to network policies and will then implement them. So the problem hereby is with the loose coupling is that you don't get any feedback. So for example, if you use a CNI plugin like Flannel that doesn't really implement network policies, you don't get any feedback. So you create the network policy as an object, but you never get any feedback that this policy doesn't take any effect. And the same is if you use some more complex network policies, it's hard to know what network policies or what of the complete stuff is supported in the CNI plugin, for example. So if a CNI plugin says, yes, we are supporting network policies, does that mean it supports all different variations in the network policies, for example? Or does it mean it only supports some basic network policies, for example? So and another thing is, this list is not complete, and there are a ton of CNI plugins. Some are better documented, some are not so good documented, and some of them I never heard. They are just some CNI plugins from the official documentation, and it's pretty hard to predict which of all these tools implement network policies and also implement them correctly, for example. And another thing we identified, for example, was an issue with Reef, so that Reef, for example, in the default settings doesn't implement all network policies correctly. So if you have some network policies and the traffic was routed locally on the same node, for example, then network policies didn't take any effect, which was a little bit bad. Yeah, so the next one is this wonderful network policy. Who can spot a difference? This little guy. And it's pretty hard to read, but it has a complete different meaning of these two policies. For example, these both statements are ANDed. And if I add another minus in front of the second statement, so in front of the pod selector, these two statements get OR and not AND. And that is pretty tricky to get it right and to spot some mistakes like this, for example. And the next one is Kubernetes is a pretty fast-moving project. So they have a release cycle of every 3 months, for example. And it's pretty hard to predict if you update your kubeproxy, for example, to a new release. Are there some new bugs introduced? It's still software. Bugs will be there. Or, for example, if you switch to IPvS instead of the standard or default IPv tables modus, are the network policies still taking effect? Or are there some side effects, for example, that network policies doesn't take effect? And the next one is, if I update my CNI plugin to a new version, does it still work? Are there some bugs? Are there some other problems, for example? Or if I use the Kubernetes network policies with some custom network policies of the CNI plugin, like Calico, which also supports global network policies, how are they working together, for example? It's pretty hard to predict if you have a fairly large setup or a fairly complex setup. Yeah. And another good thing is if you run any conformance tests, for example, they don't test any network policies because network policies support is nothing that is required to have a conformant Kubernetes cluster. So you have to do it for yourself, for example. And now is the big question, okay, we saw there are some problems or some black spots that we should test maybe. And what can we now actually test in our setup? So if you take a look at this little picture, so we have on the left side, or on the right side from your point of view, the operator or the developer that creates network policies, for example. And then we have the SDN control plane, which is not something like a classical control plane, which is a monolithic controller. And then we have the data plane, which is often IP tables or IPset that does the actual implementation. And on the left, on the right side, we can check for conformance, for example. So we can test if every namespace has a default deny network policy, or we can validate that front-end namespaces should never talk to back-end namespaces, or some other stuff, for example. The other two things we can test are the policies taking actual effect, for example. So if I create a network policy, is it implemented by the CNI plugin? And is it implemented correctly, for example? And there are two testing strategies at the end. So I can test it active, for example. That means I will send some traffic and I get feedback that the TCP handshake was successful or it didn't work, for example. And UDP testing is a little bit harder than TCP testing. And the other approach would a passive approach, which means I just hang, I use TCP dump or something else to transport my traffic to another station, and it will watch which traffic was sent in my cluster, for example. This has the drawback, obviously, that I can only see connections that are actually made, and I won't see any black holes, for example. So security issues. Yeah, and obviously I want to validate the synchronization. So maybe my data plane implements the network policies, but it lacks some synchronization, for example, so that the policies are only implemented 10 minutes after I created them or 1 hour after I created them, for example, which can be a critical component. Yeah, and now I hand over to Maximilian.
Thanks, Johannes. So hopefully at this point you are convinced, okay, maybe I should test my policies. This stuff isn't as easy as it looks. And I want to tell you a little bit more about how you could actually do it in practice. So going back to the picture, I think Johannes said much of the stuff you need to know. So we can test the conformance, and we can do that basically by using kubectl get network policies. And then we just see, okay, what network policies do we have? What workloads do we have in our cluster? Is this compliant with the high-level policies our company has set for security purposes? And for the write part, so synchronization and effect of policies, we can test passively, which has, again, the drawback that we only see traffic that is actually generated, like traffic we can read from our workloads in the cluster, or we can test actively, so that would be like a curl or a wget, and see like what is actually possible in the cluster. So we have two pods, and we want to see, can they communicate? And then we do a curl from one pod to another pod, and then we say, OK, it wasn't allowed. And then we look at our network policies and say, OK, yeah, there was a network policy. That was exactly what we expected. So what we focus on, furthermore, for the techniques of testing is this write part. So we want to actively test from the data plane, basically end to end. So we always have like the setup. We want to see, does actual traffic from one pod to another pod work? And how we can do that is we can just launch a new pod. So you saw an example network policy. It uses pod selectors to select some labels. So here it could be app foo. And if we now want to test if app foo can connect to any other pod, we just basically copy the pod spec. So we have a pod that is definitely selected, or just the labels. And then we use our own container. And this container is basically a wget or curl or nmap. And that is launched against any other workload, like any service that we want to connect to or don't want to connect to. Yeah. And if we want to go lower, so if we have some host access, we can also do it like a little bit from behind. so we go in the Docker, like we ask Docker, OK, what containers are running on my node? And we match that up with our pods that we want to test. And then we search for the pause container of the pod that we want to test. So like our app foo pod from before has a pause container. This pause container has the network namespace, so implementation details. But we can simply say docker run dash dash net and use the pause container and hook into that network. And then our runner is behaving exactly in term like for Kubernetes as if it was the foo container. Or we can go even lower and just say, OK, we are on the node already. We use Linux namespaces directly. So basically, using NSEnter or another tool, we just enter the network namespace of our tested pod, of our source pod that we want to generate traffic from. And then we use, again, a tool like curl or nmap or anything to establish whether a connection is allowed or not. And the upside for this approach is it works with containerd also. So the Docker approach only works with the specific container runtime you implemented it for, which would be Docker mostly. But when we worked on this, we had a problem that we didn't have Docker on our systems, but containerd. So we took this approach. And yeah, the upside of this approach is basically we are, or the down, no, sorry, the downside of this approach is we are reliant on Linux namespaces, and we need some big privileges. And if we don't have them, or if we are using Windows containers, this won't work. Yeah. So leading over to basically a fourth approach, which I didn't really mention, is we could just use kubectl exec, right? So we exec into our existing pod and use wget. So the obvious downside is we have to include a binary here just for testing something, and we don't even want to use the binary most of the time, so we have some potentially higher attack surface. And this also leads into the first way how you could actually like go home to your cluster and test it. So you just use kubectl exec. In this example, we have a default deny policy. I don't know, has anybody not seen this? Like, OK, no. Yeah, OK, so everybody knows what we're talking about. So no traffic is allowed. So we just use wget from the foo container. We use the bar container service address. And we see, OK, download timed out. Our policy worked as we expected. Yeah, then there's a tool called NetAssert. There's a GitHub link on the bottom. You can go to there and use it. So how this tool works is you have a config, and you write it yourself. So going back to the example from before, we have a foo pod and a bar pod, and we want to like target deployments. That's the only thing they are supporting currently. So our foo pod in default namespace should reach our bar pod in default namespace on TCP port 80. And what it does with that information is SSHs into your node that contains this foo pod. So that has some prerequisites, like it queries the Kube API, but we're going to keep it simple here. So basically, it SSHs there, and then it uses Docker run dash dash net. So that approach I explained before. So it basically hooks into the POS container and launches a container there with a simple JavaScript file. Like any executable would work here, but that's how they implemented it. And that in turn passes the test cases it received and uses nmap. And then it basically behaves like it was the foo pod and queries the bar pod. And then it matches that against the expectations and tells you, OK, your pod was reachable or your pod wasn't reachable. Yeah. And another tool, so shameless plug, the tool that we developed is Illuminatio. We're going to be on GitHub very soon, we hope. So soon TM. And we took a little bit a different approach because like one thing we lacked in our setup was direct SSH access to every node. And we also wanted to go a little bit more Kubernetes native basically. So what we do is we also query the API server for policies and stuff, so we get all that information we want. And then we construct our own test cases. I'm going to talk about it a little bit more later, but just keep in mind. So we construct our test cases, so we look at the policies, what should be allowed and what shouldn't. And then we generate a config for our runner and put that in a config map in Kubernetes. And then we launch a daemon set with our runners, and each runner on its node looks at, OK, which of these test cases that were generated for me and put in this config map can I fulfill? So which pods are on my node? And we use NSEnter because we also didn't have Docker. And then again, hook into the network namespace of our test pod. So for the same test case as from the slide before, we hook into the foo network namespace, and then we also have an executable, this time in Python. It's just personal preference. And also use nmap again to establish, OK, did it work or didn't it work? And then our executable sees, OK, yeah, we could reach bar or we couldn't, and puts that in a config map again. And our executable on the local laptop, like Illuminatio, can again read this config map. And with the data in this config map, match against the expectations and tells you, OK, this worked, or OK, this didn't work. So going to test case generation. Yeah, here we have another network policy. I just want to go back to the basics a little bit to explain like the problem with test case generation or what we have to look at. So the red part is basically the selector part of a network network policy. So each policy takes effect in the namespace it was put to, which is default in this very example. And it only affects pods selected by the pod selector, which could also be empty to select every pod. And as soon as you put this network policy without a green part into your cluster, every pod is isolated that is selected by this policy. And then you have to add rules, ingress usually, but you can also use egress rules. And these rules are then used to describe via selectors again, like you saw before, to state what should be allowed, like what traffic should my app Prometheus pod actually be allowed to accept. So we have basically two kinds of tests. We want to test that our app Prometheus pod is reachable by pods that are in this ingress rule. And we also want to be sure that it is not reachable, because it's isolated, by any pod that isn't affected by the ingress rule. Yeah. And we can also, sorry, we can also match that with the information which pods are in the cluster to see if actual workloads are affected by this rule. So we have these two kinds of tests. We have two pods in our cluster. One now matches the ingress rule because it has the app equals Grafana label. And another pod doesn't have any labels at all, so it doesn't match the rule. So we expect the left pod, pod B, to be allowed to connect to our app Prometheus. And we expect pod C to to not be allowed to connect. So that's what this policy states. And that's what we have to look after when we pull these policies from our API server. So the next problem then is what actually happens if we have two policies that might or might not affect the workloads in my cluster. So I just told you if a pod is selected by a network policy via the spec pod selector, then it's isolated. And every ingress rule allows then traffic that can reach this pod. And if you have multiple policies, all the pods that are selected by any policy whatsoever are isolated. And all the ingress rules that target any pod are then used to allow connections. So in this very case, we have a policy on the left that you already saw. So this allows our Grafana app pods, but only those. And on the right, we have a wildcard pod selector. So just think we are in the same namespace here. And we have another ingress rule that allows special pods from another namespace. And this has the unexpected side effect that our very same namespace is also selected by this namespace selector. So in this very case, the bottom pod, which we didn't want to reach our pod A because it doesn't have the app Grafana label, would reach pod A. So we have to really look at what pods are there in the cluster, how could which policies are there, how could they intersect, and we have to be very careful. And that's also an upside of Illuminatio, because the way we generate tests, you would see in this case, okay, we generated a test case that states pod B should reach pod A. And at this point, if you reach this test case and wonder, okay, I didn't expect this, you can look at your policies and see, okay, yeah, I actually have a policy that allows this. So it also allows you, in some cases, to fix your policies. Yeah. So wrapping all these things up, the question you're now basically left with is, what can we do with this? Should I like go home and use your tool or whatever? Going back to like this overview, we have a variety of tools you could use, like for the write part that we talked about now. I told you Illuminatio or NetAssert would work. So NetAssert has the only drawback that it requires Docker and SSH access. But if you have that, use it. It's pretty cool. And then you write your config, and you can like verify that what you thought your network policy state, they state. And if you only want to look at the policies in your cluster, like you have some high-level policies that state, I always want the default deny policy in each of my namespaces to isolate them, then you can use kube audit. So it has an audit check that does exactly that. So all namespaces should be isolated with a default deny policy, and no namespace should allow any traffic. So no namespace should be have a default allow policy. And there's also OPA, which you probably heard about. Because it's, I think it's like at least on KubeCon, it was everywhere. And what it does is you can write your own rules, Rego they are called, and integrate it with Kubernetes to pull the policies once. So that's the bottom instance of the symbol. And then just in your Rego rules, describe what you expect these policies to do. So you could do the very same thing where you say, for each namespace in my cluster, there should be a default deny policy. And for non-namespace in my cluster, there should be a default allow policy. And you can also use it as admission controller, which is pretty cool. So if you have like a multi-tenant cluster or something, and one of your teams applies a policy in any namespace that doesn't match your higher level compliance policies, then OPA can check this with rules that you wrote yourself and say, OK, this policy isn't allowed. And Kubernetes won't even accept it at any point. So, quick recap, we think you should test your assumptions. So, like you wrote your network policies at some point and you had some thoughts what they should state and what should they mean. And you should really at least do some manual testing, exec into some pods and see did it work, didn't it work. Just because cluster setups can be so complicated and your policy might not even be supported by your networking plugin. We also think regression testing makes your life easier. So if you have a tool in place that is a little bit more powerful than manually testing, so any of those from the slide before, then you should also run it continuously and integrate continuously. So you know, I just upgraded my Kube proxy, but everything's still working. Or I just upgraded my CNI plugin, and everything's still working. And so our like personal statement is, yeah, network policies are hard to get right. It's not that obvious, like we've shown in that example with the little dash that changes basically everything, changes like the whole meaning of the policy, and it's hard to spot. And so, yeah, because of the lack of feedback, you should just test it. And we also think there should be maybe implemented some feedback. Yeah. And what you also should check is something Johannes already named, is does it work for services and pods? Because there was a special case in Weave, I think that issue still exists, where if your traffic is on one node and goes over a service, it won't work. So yeah, the quick recap is basically test it, do it. So that's it from us. Thanks for listening. If you have any questions, I think we have some time left.